So today we're going to talk about the question of modernity, post-modernity, and the significance that that has for our traditions and for our lives as, you know, people in the contemporary period. And we have on tonight Esme Partridge. Esme, would you like to introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Esme. I'm recently graduating, in the process of graduating, from religion, a religious studies course at SOAS in London. And I have a particular interest in Islamic studies and also classical Islamic theology, metaphysics. And I'm also really interested in how these things interact with the secular age.
And this is basically why we're doing this, is because you put out a question on Twitter and I thought maybe you could just resume that question here for the audience.
Sure. So I've been doing some research on postmodernity, and particularly what problems does postmodernity pose for traditional religious metaphysics. And before studying this, I've generally researched modernity, and particularly Enlightenment modernity, and I've grappled with the question of how does the epistemological axiom, basically, of the Enlightenment, how does that influence religion? So now I've moved on to postmodernity, and then through studying these things alongside each other, I thought to myself, okay, which one's actually worse for religious tradition? And there's a lot to pick apart in that question, which I'm sure we'll come on to discussing. So I thought I'd ask people on Twitter, because how else to resolve a qualm like that? And the question was basically for religious people. Which was, I guess, quite broad. Which do you feel to be more of a predicament for your faith? Enlightenment modernity, I think I just said modernity, or postmodernity? And I actually think that the result, it was, I think 55% of people said they felt that postmodernity was worse, more of a predicament for belief, which is very interesting. Not that surprising, although I suppose it was only a slight majority.
Did you include a show results option? Did you do the calculating of the others and the random people in your comments talking nonsense?
Oh, no, I actually didn't. My data collection is not that advanced. I just took it at face value.
Because I took the strong position that obviously modernity is worse and post-modernity is much better.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what was your reasoning for?
Well, that's the background for the episode, is that you asked me, well, why? And I said, well, we should do an episode on it. And then you sent me this lovely paper, which I will include in the description of the podcast, called Islam and the Postmodernist Deconstruction of Meta-Narratives, Epistemological and Sociological Implications by Imad Bazzi. And in this paper, basically, Bazzi puts forth this question a bit longer than a tweet. It's only a few pages long. It's not terribly long. And if it's okay with you, Esme, I thought I would just read a couple quotes from the paper that lay out the stakes.
Yeah, go ahead.
So, the position and role of reason in the Quran play a vital role in understanding Islam's relationship with both modernity and postmodernism. This is because, in many accounts, modernity involves the diffusion of rationalism in all spheres of life, and the main concern of postmodernism is oriented toward the deconstruction of the assumptions and promises of instrumental reason. It can be argued that the Quran does not accord reason, in the conventional modernist sense, a foundational or sovereign status. This has serious consequences for Islam's epistemological relationship with postmodernism, as well as the postmodern condition, as it is manifested in the socio-political field. Of major concern in this regard is whether or not Islam constitutes a meta-narrative in the postmodernist sense, and how this impacts upon its relationship with both modernity and postmodernism. And I think whatever somebody's background, you could substitute Islam and the Quran for, you know, Taoism and the I Ching, or Tao Te Ching, or for Christianity and the Bible, or whatever. You know, any tradition could be substituted in here. And I think it's really an interesting question. I just wanted to focus in on this concept of the stakes, which, and, you know, Esme, correct me if you think I'm wrong, but the stakes are essentially, you know, in modernism, we have a single universal reason that dictates objective truth. And in postmodernism, we have, you know, he's following Lyotard here, and for the moment, I will not, you know, debate with Lyotard, this idea of this incredulity to that kind of a meta-narrative. And so in your thinking about it, Esme, how do you make sense of these stakes?
Yeah, so I think a particularly useful analytical framework to apply here would be the distinction between solid modernity and liquid modernity, which is, of course, coined by Zygmunt Bauman, who's an excellent sociologist and I think addresses this problem very, very lucidly. So for Bauman, this Enlightenment modernity, this solid modernity, is upheld by, as you say, this fixed notion of reason, which is a universal in itself. And it is a meta-narrative, and it's one which is upheld by these almost steel-like structures. And you see that in the Industrial Revolution and the infinite march towards progress, where everything becomes rationalized. And with the Industrial Revolution, as I say, things become so solid and upheld by these pillars of steel, a bit like in Brave New World. You've got the idea of Henry Ford and that level of hard capitalism, solid capitalism. Meanwhile, liquid modernity is basically the melting and the dissolution of all of these structures, at both a ideological level, because you've got this incredulity toward meta-narratives and there's this general suspicion towards objective truth, which is how Ernest Gellner defines postmodernity. But it's also physical, actually. If you compare, you know, the solid structures of the Industrial Revolution, that was seen as progress, that was seen as the ideal. And now that's all also melted away, and we have things like the internet, which are invisible and can move at such speeds. It is liquid, it's defying the usual obstacles that solid infrastructure has to face. So I suppose I just raise that because I think it's obviously a very visual way of understanding the distinction between modernity and postmodernity. I think a particularly interesting question, and one of the things which was raised in that in the extract you just read, was the question of, is Islam a meta-narrative? And if so, what does postmodernity mean for it? Because does it mean melting that meta-narrative, or does it mean opening new possibilities for being religious, being Muslim, or, you know, being somebody who believes in objective truth? I mean, what are your initial thoughts? Does Islam constitute a meta-narrative, or indeed any religion, as you say?
Well, I think there are some details here from the paper that I'm going to just elaborate before I give my response, which is, there's this conception of, you know, what is reason? You know, what is the critique of reason in postmodernity? And, you know, he gives three critiques. The first is that reason is partly fed by the subconscious. The second is that it's parochial and that it's, you know, culturally determined or whatever. And the third is that it's implicated in the knowledge power paradigm. Or, like, if you're really Foucauldian, you would say that, you know, knowledge and power are basically, you know, there's a debate onto how equivocal those terms really are. And then when we come to the question of, well, is Islam a meta narrative? You have these sort of two criteria of a meta-narrative, and one is that it constitutes reality and knowledge offering a prescription of, quote, the good life, and secondly, it justifies this claim about the good life through appeal to allegedly universal and objective criteria like modern science or universal reason. And I think, I don't want to pick apart what you said, but at one point you said, you know, reason is a universal, and I think for this discussion we should be a little bit more metaphysical and say that that's not what we're discussing. We're saying that reason is universal. It's not a universal. The claim is that it's universal, like, mm-hmm. everyone has access to it, right? Mm-hmm. And I guess for me, that this is, as somebody that has, you know, my background is somebody that really seriously studied postmodernism. I went to the postmodernist home university. Mm-hmm. There's this conception of, you know, if I'll draw out the stakes one more step and then I'll respond. If reason really is universal, and I can use reason in the sort of Enlightenment sense to establish some objective truth, like the objective truth about how women should behave, for example. So the role of a woman in marriage, I can ascertain that universally and objectively. And that is what constitutes the good life. If that is the case, then I am justified in subjecting women to that standard for their own good. If you were to refuse that standard, you'd either be mentally ill, somehow perverse, maybe you have some kind of, you know, demon or mental illness or, you know, neurosis or something going on. And this is what justifies the architecture of, you know, power to come in and dictate to you, Esme, this is how you must live, right? And that's a direct logical implication of modernity. And that's why modernity produced, you know, totalitarianism and everything else. Mm-hmm. And where I would make my objection, and I'm not going to speak for Islam because I'm not a Muslim, but as a Christian, I would say that I don't think that reason is universal. And well, I'd like to have you respond also, but my brief take, you know, he's talking about the Quran, I'll speak about the scriptures. Following Father John Baer and others who have written about this, the scripture is scripture in the sense that it's cryptic. The scriptures are not clear. Reformed Protestants, Baptists, etc. are wrong when they say that the scriptures are perspicuous. In fact, they're cryptic. And we know this because when Christ, Paul, for example, was persecuting the Christians, he was an expert in the law. He was a Jewish rabbi of, you know, the greatest order. He studied under Rabbi Gamaliel. And then he stops because he has this sort of mystical experience of Christ, and he interprets the scriptures in a completely different way. Mm-hmm. Did he not understand the scriptures to begin with? Why in the Gospels does nobody understand what's going on the whole way through until Christ dies and resurrected and opens the scriptures to them after his resurrection? I think the scriptures have to be opened, I guess, is what I would say. And that opening is because there's this kind of cryptic question, like, it, you know, it's not accessible to everyone. The truth is not accessible. So my sort of epistemological position would be that there is a sort of absolute or objective truth, but it's not obvious, it's not easy to get, and it's certainly not universal. I cannot demonstrate to everyone the truth of the gospel, right? You and I might be really close in terms of Neoplatonist sort of influences or interests or whatever, but I don't think I can just logically, you know, present to you the truth of the gospel and you will see it. You know, there has to be some kind of mystical experience.
Yeah, well, this is quite widely acknowledged in traditional Islamic epistemology, in which there are different gradations of intellection. You have the sense perception level of intellection, and then you have the more imaginative one, which is where you're able to perceive meanings, or I think Ibn Sina uses the term ma'ana, which basically means meaning, but has quite a noetic dimension to it in this context. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of the second level, or maybe third level. You can actually perceive interior meanings from sense data. And then there are further ranks as you go further above. I'm not going to list all of them because different philosophers have different systematizations. For some, there's five intellects, I think. Something of seven, but the point is that there is a hierarchy, and different individuals are able to ascertain different levels. And of course, the highest level of intellect, which is actually conjunction with the active intellect, which is basically an extra mental, suprasensory realm of Platonic forms, if you will, or just eternal truth. That is a level of intellection which you can only get through the mystical experience. Mm-hmm. And Al-Ghazali, although he's quite different from people like Al-Farabi for obvious reasons, he asserts very much that this you know, type of pure perception into the absolute truth, it is, I think, as he describes it, it's a light that shines directly into your heart. It's you moving beyond the trappings of rationality and reasoning as we know it in the Enlightenment sense of the word, because all these things are very cognitive. They're not actually eternal. They are basically processed through the corporeal sense organs, and therefore are, you know, reflective of the physical world and not eternal truths. So to sort of just go back to the original point you were raising about rationalism, right? Is there such thing as a universal rationalism? I would argue that I think there is a universal truth. I know that's not quite what you were asking, but we do have different degrees of being able to apprehend that truth.
Yeah, and I think this is, I mean, I, for example, tend to I think the most poetic and succinct description of how this works is found in Lao Tzu, with this concept of, you know, the Tao, which could be translated as reason if you wanted to. You know, the true reason cannot be spoken of, right? The true, you know, way is not a way that I can just sit here and pronounce. And that doesn't mean that we can say nothing, right? And this is sort of where the tradition of apophatic theology and mysticism in Christianity comes into play. But you can see this even just in a simple reading of the Gospel of John. Like, we don't ascertain propositions about ultimate truth. We have ultimate reason, like the word, the logos, the Tao became flesh and dwelt among us. It's like a personal relationship that we have, that we establish. I don't really know how that works in Islam. I feel like in Islam you would have more of a classical Neoplatonic epistemology in that sense.
Well, I suppose not necessarily.
Or I can give a brief example, which is if you read, for example, in St. Athanasius, his short work on the life of Anthony, the father of Egyptian desert monasticism, there's an exchange, which I won't recount here, where basically some Greek philosophers come and try to sort of dispute with St. Anthony, who's been alone in this mountain fighting demons for months, you know. And he comes and he just confounds them immediately with simple, very simple remarks, you know. He doesn't have this whole, he doesn't present to them a systematic theology that blows them over. And I think this is something that maybe in the ancient world was easier to perceive, is that there's a life of the philosopher, and that that true philosophy, which for me is the same as true religion, is a form of life. It's connected to a form of life. And when you come and you see St. Anthony and you've seen that he's been living with, you know, nothing but occasional bread and water for years battling demons, the philosophers are ashamed, you know, because they recognize, you know, they can see that, you know, this form of asceticism is called the philosophical form of life in that period of time. So, sorry, that was a long response.
No, it's a great story. And I think, yeah, it does definitely highlight what I was trying to convey there about there being this way of connecting with God, which is so much more, you know, apophatic, I suppose. It is beyond the constructs of language. Oh, wow, did I just call the language a construct? Ooh, that was very, very, very modern of me. which maybe is a good invitation to go back to the kind of task at hand, which was, yeah, about whether Islam is a meta-narrative. I mean, I'm very skeptical about this word, and that's not just...
I mean, Wahhabism is probably meta-narrative.
Yeah, well, this is the problem, because it's sort of, you have to ask the tedious question of, well, which kind of Islam are we referring to? Which is slightly tedious, because it doesn't get to the bottom of the theological question, which I think should be answered. But it is important to take into consideration, because in a way, and this is a bit of a tangent, but we can come back to this, you know, it's a pretty well-known observation that modernity, as in Enlightenment modernity, and its products, so nationalism based on the nation state and all those kinds of things, those have, of course, become very transplanted in the Islamic world. I mean, even the Iranian Revolution, for example, of course, it was, you know, trying to revive something which is much more primordial, but did it in the context of a modern republic, you know, of a sort of nation.
But praised by Foucault himself.
Yeah, well, that is curious. It's curious. No, I haven't fully delved into that, but I have heard somebody say that before. But the point is that modernism has affected Islam. And so I suppose in that context, you could say that the expressions of Islam, which have become so deeply imbued with these modern concepts, such as the nation state and other very modern kind of dogmatisms, which, yeah, I suppose could be identified as almost, you know, Enlightenment born. I suppose in that sense, one would be more comfortable to call those systems of Islam meta-narratives, because they uphold many of those modern meta-narratival principles. But that said, it always feels somewhat feels too much like we're bringing it too much down to earth, when I don't think that that's very true to the actual essence of any theological system, and especially Islam.
We could do the reverse, and that might be clarifying. I think we could agree that the Druze faith is probably the least like a meta-narrative of any form of Islam.
Mm-hmm.
Like, literally, they if you teach somebody it, they will put you to death. That's probably the least universal. Like, it's only us. Mm-hmm. It's only our group.
Mm-hmm.
And it's completely, but in a sense, it does kind of fall to that idea of it being socially, I mean, it's completely socially determined. It's totally ethnically determined.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, the universal quality of it, the sense of, That piece of the meta-narrative is a sort of sine qua non. If that falls, then you don't have a meta-narrative. But I don't know if that works for you as well.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think, as you say, the social factors are important. And certainly when we're diagnosing something as being a meta-narrative or not, we do have to consider what kind of sociological elements are at play, which do characterize it as being this sort of truth, which is being imposed at a material sociological level. But I think when answering that question in terms of, you know, is Islam as a whole a meta-narrative, I don't think we should. I think it's somewhat of a fallacy to immediately project a sort of socio-historical materialist conception, because kind of embedded into the concept of a meta-narrative in its original designation is the idea that knowledge is constructed, and that it's a narrative which has been written by somebody, by some, you know, playwright who has the power to influence the people in that society. And this is inherently a very, I suppose it's quite a Foucauldian way of looking at religion, which does reduce it to these more hegemonic power structures and not so much the truth as truth in itself, which is what Islam would certainly assert itself to be.
I think you would agree that truth is synonymous with power. It's just we would take issue with Foucault's conception of power. But the truth-power relation is fine. Because the true, yeah, the good, the beautiful, the truly powerful, right? All of these are synonymous in the one.
Mm-hmm. No, I know. I'm glad you raised that. I think it's definitely important to be nuanced. But no, I think, yeah, exactly. I think that is the nuance, isn't it? It's, well, it's not the Foucauldian perspective of power, or rather how he diagnoses power and what its origins are, which is in a sort of very reductive conception of the human being, which just simply wants to assert power on other people. I mean, maybe that is slightly too reductive, but I think. But he is reductive, so I suppose.
And this is where, for Christians, we have this like power of paradox. I don't know that it really exists in Islam. Like for us, the true power, like I think we would agree that, you know, God is the true power, good, etc., etc. And for us, that's revealed in the form of a crucified slave, right? So if you, the true king is the one who hung on the cross and died and rose again. That's true leadership, right? Mm-hmm. That's our nation. Like Chrysostom talks about. You know, we have no association with earthly nations, cities, etc., right? We are the people even talk about the race of Christians, but it's completely divorced from this sort of, you know, I'm not English, I'm not American, I'm not whatever. Mm-hmm. And so there's sort of this paradoxical inversion of what is, you know, what in that time period would have been considered normative of this domination, slavery, etc., etc. And when you read like Gregory of Nyssa talking about slavery, well, I won't get into that, but it's like totally radical. No, I mean, it's breaking with so many cultural norms. And I don't really know how that works in Islam, because I feel like you have a different conception of the relationship between God and the powers that be, so to speak.
Yeah, I think that's fair to say. But with regards to, I mean, I think, but there's different levels, isn't there? I mean, there's temporal power and then there's divine power. And I think that would be where the key difference lies. Just to generalize, basically, I think that you know, saying that Islam is a meta narrative just on the basis of the powers that it has over the people, which, as you say, are obviously, you know, quite nuanced in this religion. But it's more, you know, power from above, and that's the nature of revelation. It is that ultimate, power which is completely beyond the human understanding of the term at a cognitive level. It's so much more transcendent than that. And I think it's almost blasphemous in a way to assume that power can be equated with temporal power, and to say that it's a meta-narrative in that sense, and that, oh, well, it was revealed by a human being, and so it's therefore the message of a given human being in a given temporal context, because that does run contrary to the nature of Islam as a revealed religion, and indeed most spiritual systems, which of course are about setting apart the sacred from the profane, as Durkheim would say.
Mm-hmm. So when it comes back to this question, I know we're a little bit more limited on time than a traditional forms podcast, so I'm trying not to rush you, but I also don't want to keep you past your availability. When it comes to discussing modernity and postmodernity, it just seems very obvious to me that postmodernity gives the tools necessary not only to destroy modernity, but to destroy itself. That is, the hermeneutic of suspicion can be applied reflexively, and okay, you know, the first emperor has new clothes, you know, long live the king is dead, the new king has no clothes. And then you're kind of in this open, you're back to this open position where you can look at, all right, well, what do we do now? And I think that's a place where sort of revival of, for example, Neoplatonic, to use a shorthand, metaphysics can just walk back in. You see that with Agamben, Benjamin, Levinas. I mean, there's a lot of people that are coming in with bringing metaphysics back, baby.
I like your analogies there. Firstly, it's a bit pedantic, but I think one does have to have a nuance in how you're defining postmodernity, because I have read quite an interesting argument that postmodernity is itself a kind of tradition. I don't agree with this argument at the end of the day, but it's kind of worth entertaining. I believe it was Timothy Luke, the sociologist, who is quite cynical of this idea that postmodernity is anti-traditional, because he says, well, but maybe postmodernity is a kind of traditionalized modernity. I think he describes it with roots in, you know, avant-garde art and silent films and department stores, I think. So I agree that as an aesthetic, obviously there is a sort of traditional element to postmodernity as a zeitgeist, or as a, and you see that in architecture and music and all those kinds of things. But I think what we're talking about here is we're not talking about that kind of aesthetic postmodernism. We're talking about the condition of postmodernity, which is inherently amorphous. It is liquid, as Bauman says. It doesn't take a shape, because it's based on basically a polemical thrust against shape, because it believes that all shapes are social constructs and so we must kind of escape them and bend around them in whatever way we want. So I see where you're coming from, in the sense that there's a lot of hope in that, because in the process of melting away those structures or those meta narratives of modernity, there's a sort of potential for hope there, isn't there, among religious people, because you can say, okay, well, we're deconstructing this modernity as secularism, in a way. If you see, kind of, I know obviously the Enlightenment didn't directly lead to secularism, but you know, through it.
Oh, I definitely think it did.
Yeah, through a progression. People always tell me off when I say that, because they're right. You know, it's a bit more complicated. But even deism, you can see how that has. You know, prefigured secularism as we know it today. But let's not go down there, because I think that's quite comfortably say that the Enlightenment is inextricably linked to the project of secular modernity. And so in that respect, if we're going postmodern, then we're also potentially going post-secular. And in the article that we mentioned earlier, there does seem to be, you know, a few voices being presented. There are people who do believe this. You know, well, this is actually quite good for say Islam, or indeed any other anti-Enlightenment, any belief system which counters the austere kind of empiricist and naturalist currents of the Enlightenment is seen as a good thing. Well, I've got a couple of things to say about that. My first one is a criticism of that claim, which I think is raised in the article itself, which is that actually postmodernity in an indirect way actually allows the propagation of many, I suppose you could say, Western hegemonies, in the sense that it's effective in detraditionalizing. And I mean, detraditionalization is a very important thing to draw on here, in the sense that it's co-constitutive with postmodernity, and that when society becomes so globalized and in an ironic way so atomized, because everybody's dispersed over different places, and particularly through the internet, we're exposed to so many different images and sounds and also ideologies in a very fragmented and blizzard-like fashion. It's inevitable that we start to question the objectivity around us, and as a result, we get detraditionalization in its fullest form. There is just no binding. There's nothing which presents itself as being objective, because it's just a plurality of truths. And in that sense, that detraditionalization, that does seem like a very modern thing, because it's still the result of progress. If you see globalization, the internet, this sort of incredible advances in technology, those are also a product of the same modernity, which has these detraditionalizing and ultimately individualizing forces. So you could say, well, postmodernity is basically this taken to its full extreme. It's basically modernity on steroids, in that sense. And I'd also like to say, going back to Bauman, who I know I'm referencing a lot, but it's a great...
Feel free.
A great analogy. Well, something that Bauman doesn't, I don't think he actually says this himself, but it's implicit, and I would like to raise this, is that, so what I just said was basically, you know, postmodernity is, yeah, modernity on steroids. It's just the same ideological ilk of modernity taken to an extreme. You could interpret Bauman's metaphor of the solid and the liquid to come to a very similar conclusion. So although solid modernity and liquid modernity are obviously different states, they appear very different. Imbued in that very metaphor is the idea that they're actually the same substance. You know, it's like the solidity of hard modernity, when it melts, it looks totally different, but it's from the same chemical substance, effectively. And as I say, that substance is the are these kind of anthropocentric, detraditionalizing, individualizing forces. And that does seem to be the way that postmodernity is going, and particularly on the internet, the suspicion or the incredulity towards religion actually seems to have gone to an even greater extent. I don't know how active you are on Instagram or anything like that, but
I'm not at all active.
Yeah, so it's actually very, very interesting. I mean, this was something, so I wrote my dissertation on spirituality on TikTok, which is quite unrelated to most of my other interests, I suppose, but no, also very, very related because it grapples with the same question of what is the metaphysics of modernity, basically. Mm-hmm. And anyway, something I found in trawling through TikTok and also Instagram is that in these, I suppose, this kind of ideological environment, which is very postmodern, you know, that's very much
yes.
what the social justice discourse is concerned with. Sorry, I'm going to sound like Jordan Peterson here, but it is kind of true.
I did listen to him on postmodernity and did confirm that he has no idea what he's talking about.
Yeah,
I frequently ignore this man, but you know.
Yeah, no,
I was preparing for this. I was like, okay, what do the people say about postmodernity again? And this guy just ranted, and I had no.
Yeah, it's a bit of.
There was no connection of A and B.
A bit of a rookie error. Well, also, I mean, it's quite funny because he seems to he always criticizes Marxism as being postmodern. Now, don't get me wrong, there are postmodern forms of Marxism, but that's so contradictory because actually Marxism is about as modern as you can get. If you think about everything, every aspect of Marxism, you know, technological progress, it is very anthropocentric, very materialistic.
Yeah, I dare him to come to Paris and try to say that, you know, postmodernism is just trying to sneak Marxism in the back door. That would not fly.
No, exactly. No, he makes sweeping generalizations. Hence the disclaimer, because I don't want to buy into those tropes. I'm very aware Marxism is modern by definition. But anyway, in the climate that we're seeing online in social justice discourse, if you want to call it that, but anyway, online, you do see a lot of in this discourse, which is very much about, you know, kind of deconstructing things, and it is very postmodern in a lot of ways, you could say.
Mm-hmm.
There is this real targeting towards religion, actually, especially Christianity. I've seen lots of these infographics saying, you know, your religion is a choice. My so-and-so, like my identity, my whatever, is not. And I'm not going to go into that the beliefs.
No, it's very interesting. You're in touch with the youth in a way that I am not. This is very interesting.
Well, I don't really want to be, but I suppose it's quite inescapable. Especially when I was doing research on this, I did end up exposing myself to a lot of things which I didn't expect to come across originally. Anyway, I digress. Something which I just wanted to point out was that although we did raise this possibility of postmodernity might challenge the axioms of modernity and therefore might pose the possibility of a sort of post-secular revival or a re-enchantment, even as some people have called it, this isn't empirically actually true. If anything,
well, it's debatable.
Well, yeah, no, it is debatable, but in terms of the attitude towards religion and how modernity responded to religion by sort of profaning it basically and bringing it down to a very anthropocentric level, which ultimately led to secularism, as we sort of said, but that is still very much alive and well, even in a climate which is otherwise challenging every other modern axiom. Mm-hmm. So I think it is worth pointing out empirically. On the other hand, as you say, it is more complex than that, and maybe this is a good opportunity to talk about witchcraft on TikTok, which is the flip side of that, because it's sort of they're still very much maintaining this rejection of the religious infrastructure of a pre-Enlightenment era, but they are also attempting to re-enchant in a way which I don't really doubt comes from a place of sincerity, because I mean we are living in an extremely profane times, and I think as a believer in the doctrine of innate God consciousness or in Islam the fitra, I can't help but be, you know, have faith in these movements in the sense that they do actually come from a place of wanting to seek out something higher. But again, the forms that they're manifesting in, and indeed there is a lot of manifestation, that's actually one of the practices
yes.
that they use a lot, ironically enough. It's sort of a double-edged sword, because on the one hand they're clearly trying to re-enchant. The whole aesthetic of witch talk is almost quite hallucinogenic. They're trying to go beyond the confines of naturalism. They use all these psychedelic coloured, lights and things, and they wear quite extravagant things, and it's, you know, they are wanting to transcend.
There's no such thing as a coincidence.
Yeah, no, I think that's, yeah, no, fair. But I, at the same time, there is this real not wanting to believe in objective truth. That's the underlying thing. And I've read a few papers on how postmodernism and, for example, neo-paganism are co-constitutive forces. They're two peas in a pod, really, because neo-pagan religion is very much about pluralism of deities, of gods and goddesses, which suit each individual and their own dispositions, which is quite similar.
Yeah, in this case, it's a highly neoliberal, you know, it's like pick your god or goddess or whatever. I would break in to say just one thing before I forget, which is I tend to follow Vladimir Solovyov on this, and other people like David Bentley Hart have talked about this, where really, in my view, the religion, or at least Christianity, did this to itself. Like, Christendom itself did this to itself in terms of disenchanting the world and so betraying the gospel that only sort of cretin would hold on to it. I mean, this is how some people explain the phenomenon of Nietzsche. And I think it's basically right on that, you know, the West created such an abysmal and infernal world that the people that want to defend Western civilization, I just don't really understand what it is that they want to defend. Like, the 20th century is probably the most barbaric and savage in human history. I have no interest in defending that, you know. So for me, I have this sort of extremely extreme antipathy towards that. Mm-hmm. And I can understand why somebody would look at that, look at the wreckage of, like, you know, look at the wreckage of the contemporary church and say, this is disgusting. I want nothing to do with this. So I can't blame the Zoomer, the witch talkers for their disinterest in religion. And I think it's, you know, there is an opportunity. Obviously, atheism is on the decline empirically. Mm-hmm. People report, you know, I have some spirit, like people have God consciousness, as you say. Mm-hmm. But what does that attach to? Right now, it doesn't attach to anything. It attaches to these kind of products, these sort of spiritual products. And in one generation, this could be, you know, new age spirituality. It could be neo-paganism, whatever. And it's just a question of, you know, to what degree is that actually a tradition? It doesn't really seem to be, you know, no. This kind of revive.
I think, yeah, no, there are definitely different ways of looking at it. One can be optimistic and say, well, it is ultimately still re-enchantment. It's coming from a God consciousness. And even if it's not manifesting, as it were, in a way which seems to resemble traditional religion, that doesn't mean we should completely rule it out. And indeed, there is quite a vast spectrum, I suppose, between, you know, to what extent does traditional religion accommodate some degree of individualism, and how the individuals engage with the divine in their own way. I think, you know, one can be quite hardline about these kinds of things. I think it's more dangerous to be completely free and open and say, oh, you can perceive God in everything, because then you end up in the territory of what people such as Seraphim Rose called prelest, where you're taking every strange spiritual experience to be a sign of God, which is very, very dangerous theologically, but also, well, for the soul.
Like, sure.
Naturally, and that.
I mean, we're both having this discussion. Obviously, it's possible in even, considering contemporary deracination, to try to search for a true form of life and attach to that. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's not like your only opportunity is, state atheism or witch talk. There are other alternatives, you know.
And in that sense, I suppose that is an advantage of postmodernism, because you do have that freedom, I suppose, to try and reconnect. It's sort of we're in a bit of a wasteland, I suppose, especially in the UK, because, you know, the Anglican Church is declining so rapidly. A lot of people are very drawn to Catholicism, increasing numbers of people drawn to Islam as well. But there is no clear answer. So I think in that environment, you do have to sympathize with people for, intentionally or not, being quite postmodern about how they approach their spirituality. And we're even seeing that with traditional religion, actually, which ironically, this was something I wanted to mention as well, because it's a very interesting tangent to go on. The question of let me go back to how I started thinking about this. I was talking to somebody about postmodernism, and we were talking about traditionalism, because when you talk about it, it seems they're the perfect antithesis of each other, because traditionalism is a movement which is trying to revive tradition, and postmodernism is anti-traditional. quintessentially. But then the person I was talking to said, well, no, actually, I suppose traditionalism is the ultimate postmodernism because it's one of the first revolts against modernity, which is true in a way, although I don't know if it becomes very confusing if you start using the word postmodernism to describe that, because really what they're getting at is pre-modernism, actually. That seems like an easy way of classifying that. Still, it's an interesting way of looking at things.
And you mentioned a tangent you wanted to go down?
Yeah, so I just want to talk about how postmodernism and traditional religion are creating strange syntheses, I suppose, ideologically. So one thing we mentioned before was about how a lot of modern Islamist movements are in a sense very influenced by modern nationalism. And in a roundabout way, that's also happening with postmodernity and with certain religious groups who are becoming more traditional in the face of a society which is now slowly starting to deconstruct tradition. So that's probably a bit confusing because I'm not talking about quite the same thing I just mentioned, but let me give a concrete example. So in Turkey, I'm going to use Turkey as an interesting case study. That's the word I'm looking for. Just because Turkey is, of course, seen a very systematized and nationalized, quite literally, form of secularism in the form of Kemalism. And so in Turkey, the idea of the modern, it is the secular modern. And you see this phrase a lot in Turkish sociology. It's like, the power of the power. I mean, that's Talal Assad's terminology, of course, but it's very comfortable in Turkey because, as I say, modernism was so inextricably linked to Kemalist secularism there. And so what's really interesting is that now, entering a kind of postmodern era, a lot of religious people, particularly religious women in Turkey, are actually reclaiming pre-modern, pre-secular symbols, such as the headscarf and other exterior religious mores, actually as an expression of post-modernity, as post-secularism. Is that making sense? It's just quite interesting.
I mean, we have the same situation in France where, like, the government of Macron is desperately trying to have this, like, last stand of modernity.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes out in these very... we should have a psychoanalyst on to talk about this in detail, but the sort of bizarre obsession with the Muslim body is a particularly mm-hmm. postmodern critique that could be leveled against this regime, you know, this sort of like bizarre obsession with the fact. I mean, I can walk down a street in a ghetto of Paris that's 80% Muslim or whatever, and we can have ads on the street of basically naked women. But if a woman walks by covered, that is an affront to civilization, right? That's an affront to society. And I find it to be a really bizarre juxtaposition of, you know, the French liberté is literally written on the ad. Like, this is the national identity, is the secular, totally, you know, profane image. And but that's not actually what it is anymore. Like, that's not what this community is. And this difference, and I guess I'll let you speak in just a moment. This is sort of part of my political project. And, you know, this is coming from Agamben and others. This concept of the multiplication of forms of life, which is the way out from this sort of totalizing, dominating secular worldview, is to try to break that modernity up into as many sort of islands of experimentation as possible. There's this famous book, Bolo Bolo, which goes into this. It's kind of Republic or Al-Farabi's, it's not the Celestial City, what is it called?
The Virtuous City? I mean, it is taken from Plato. Well, the political regime translated as.
Yeah, so the Bolo Bolo is basically the same kind of book, but written in, you know, the contemporary period about what if we could break the world up into, you know, basically an archipelago of, you know, millions of islands. Mm-hmm. And I think that is one way of, you know, using these forces of deracination and then deracinating the deracination, right? You deracinate it by, you know, breaking up breaking up these forces, because that's what produces the individual. Like, the true force, well, now we're getting too deep into political philosophy, is totalizing world empire. So breaking that up, yeah, like, there's a risk. I'm not going to pretend there's not risks, but we know what we have now, which is just, you know, abomination of desolation.
Well, exactly. I mean, and pragmatically, I suppose the concept of differentiated forms of life does seem quite, plus, yeah, seems quite pragmatically appealing in that respect. Although, of course, by assuming that such a plurality is permissible, I suppose that is taking quite a bold postmodern and the ultimate detraditionalization, because in a very complicated and paradoxical and meta way, you are basically traditionalizing detraditionalization. You're acknowledging that there are no traditions, and so you're formalizing the complete fragmentation of all forms of life. Intuitively, that seems to be a very artificial way of handling it. But as you say, it does. The state that we're in now, it doesn't seem. It seems any improvement might be welcomed.
And it's also just like, what are you or I supposed to do in our own daily life? All we can try to do is have healthy communities and healthy traditions. Mm-hmm, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Which is, I suppose that's the issue, isn't it? Because that in itself is not ideal. That's not how human beings are supposed to live. We are supposed to live in a collective where there are certain shared, even just a shared set of virtues, but we don't even have that at this point. And I'm not saying this just to be cynical or to rant about the state of modernity or post-modernity.
Sure.
But the point is that even if you do go about your own life following your own traditions, that is still a very atomized way of living. And
I'm assuming by when I say that it's being done in community.
Yeah, well, I am aware of that growing. I think there are in parts of the US, or is it Canada, where you are having Catholic homeschooling families coming together, and I think there was an instance where one of these organizations or communities, rather, sorry, ended up basically colonizing a village somewhere in Canada or a small town, and now it's full of homeschooling Catholics. So I suppose that's possibly the closest thing. Well, maybe not, but in the Western world anyway.
I mean, I know even secular people that go to, for example, these French universities, homes of postmodernism, and decide, okay, what we need to do is we need to go and establish communes in the sort of empty part of France. Mm-hmm. And that's where we can experiment and try to find a way out, a way forward.
Which is ironic, isn't it? Because you think that seems antithetical to the nature of something which is detraditionalizing force.
Oh, what else are they supposed to do? Just bob around Paris and get drunk? Like there's no alternative. Like they know there's a need for roots, right? We know we have a need for roots.
Yeah.
And it might be kind of fake, but what else is there to do?
But what you just said there, the need for roots, for me, that's the biggest proof that postmodernity is bunk, I suppose, to use Henry Ford's terminology. It's not that history is bunk, it's that the present is bunk, because we are going against many of our instincts. And as you say, you do need a grounding. And I think if even the postmodernists are admitting this, we need an institution, we need a community, then I think that's proof that the ideology or lack of metaphysics, lack of clear ideology that they have, I suppose, because bear in mind it's a very negative one. It's more about deconstructing than asserting anything positive. If even those people are having to form something, then I think that's proof that postmodernity is based on a weak premise. We need objective foundations. We need solid communities, and we need some solidity. And no, that solidity shouldn't be a refreezing or a recrystallization of what has
you can't go back. You can't go pretend that you're like living in
no
the Uma of 10 centuries ago or whatever.
No, I mean, some people try, but no, but no, exactly. And this is what I'm saying. It doesn't have to entail going back to a particular solid, but I think it's about coming to an organization, whatever substance that is, solid, liquid, hybrid, whatever, that's a more organic arrangement. This is the thing, because modernity in the first place was basically an assault on nature, the infinite march of progress that Weber talks about. It was always from the very beginning a project against human instinct and against the human God consciousness, because it categorically denied that such thing can exist unless it's empirically justified. So that said, a lot of what we're seeing now, it is the direct derivation, which makes me all the more convinced that postmodernity is basically this modernity in a liquid form, but nonetheless the same substance, which maybe is a good place to conclude. I'm wondering if that was...
Yeah, you'll have to... we're going to do some episode here in the future on the work of Giorgio Agamben, mostly focusing on the COVID crisis. I think that's going to be the next episode that we record. But you should read some of Gump and read Homo Caesar, one of his other books. It would be very interesting, I think, to have you come back and discuss at length more on this, because this is a very fruitful vein. I feel like this is the discussion I've been having with my friends for 5 years. So it's something that I could talk about at length, and we really appreciate you coming on.
Yeah, I'd love that.
Is there anything you want to promote or something like that? I mean, you've written quite a few articles. I haven't read all of them, but I know you've written quite a bit, and a very accomplished public intellectual there in the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland.
Well, I'm not sure about that, but thank you. I do have a website, which is just my name, esmaelkpartridge.com, and I also have Twitter, where I suppose I post most of the things I publish and also some takes of a similar nature. I do talk a lot about modernity and postmodernity and how a more traditional, broadly conceived worldview fits into that. So yeah, do feel free, it's just Esme LK Partridge. But that's about it, I think. And I hope this was interesting, and I hope it's always hard to not be opinionated, I think, and not to project one's own.
No, but that's what we're here to do. I mean, podcasting, you know, we would both agree in sort of Pache Derrida that speech is superior to writing. And or maybe you wouldn't agree with it. How does that work with the Quranic theology?
Oh, gosh, I'm not sure I could. I'm not sure.
Come back for another episode. Yeah. We'll talk about.
Personally, though, I think. I don't know. Writing, I think with writing, I have quite a butterfly brain. So I find writing hard, but it usually ends up being a clear reflection of my thought. But I hope that was.
Because the Quran was, according to tradition, dictated, was it not?
Well, I suppose you've got the idea of the command of reading, and it's sort of an active process of divine sort of flowing through consciousness.
The Quran is to be read to people. Mm. Would a Muslim say that faith comes through hearing?
Faith? I mean, I think they would say faith could definitely be animated and, I suppose, brought to life by hearing scripture, of course. Mm. But I think they would argue that it doesn't. It comes from within. It's about something being ignited. Mm-hmm. About that fitra, which I mentioned earlier, being brought out.
Well, I know we're limited in time, but I will ask one final question. If, in your theological perspective, or in the Muslim theological perspective, that inner God consciousness, how intact is that?
So, well, it depends who you ask. I think...
For you.
For me? Well, I mean, without being too confessional, I suppose, from my own background, coming from a completely secular, vague residues of Church of England, going to school church services, but that was really it. For me, the fact that I was very strongly monotheistic from I think at least the age of maybe 8 or 9, I was just very intuitively aware. I think for me that is proof, if you want to use those quite rationalist terms, proof of there being such a thing as an innate God consciousness. And an interesting passage by Ibn Taymiyyah where he says that it's that consciousness is there and it's equal among everybody, but it's the social environment which distorts it and which corrupts it, which is in a very strange way quite similar to Rousseau, the French in life, he sort of sees society as being that which corrupts the primordial human nature. Obviously, I wouldn't go down that route comparing the two thinkers, Rousseau and Ibn Taymiyyah, very strange. But no, I think that I do strongly believe that it is there and it's primordial, and I think it's just a matter of exposing yourself to the right things which evoke it.
But you would not agree with St. Paul that everyone is in suppression of the truth.
I'd have to think about that one. I think
we'll have to think about that and come back on about the question of God consciousness.
A longer question, but no, very interesting stuff. And thank you so much for having me on. I found this really interesting, and lots to think about. But I would like to know. I would, if people have any further thoughts about whether they think postmodernity or modernity is worse for religious worldview, I would definitely be interested to hear people's concluding thoughts.
Oh, and in conclusion, you still think modernity is better? Because you did not defend that thesis.
I didn't defend that thesis. I think this is sort of, I suppose, taking a slightly pedantic approach. I think they're effectively the same thing. And I think postmodernity is an exaggeration of the former, at least in its current form. And so in that sense, I think modernity is worse at being the root of it, being the impetus for what we're seeing now. I think that
we wouldn't be having this conversation 30 years ago, 40 years ago. That just wouldn't be happening. And I'm thankful that we can have this conversation. You know, I don't think that, like, growing up in the Church of England in 1920, you would never be able to come to this kind of, like, the only way you could approach Islam would be through a sort of crude Orientalism.
Yes, no, exactly. That's the thing. I think one has to consider and be quite grateful in a way for what the physical opportunity.
You gotta take the good with the bad.
No, exactly.
But we thank you very much. And if you have any final remarks.
No, I don't think so. But as I say, it would be very interesting to hear people's thoughts, especially after hearing this conversation, which one's worse. But other than that, thank you very much.
All right, ciao.